Excellency Ahmed Albano, His Excellency Sri Govardhan, Sri Ajay Singh, Sri Narayan Rao, Sri Ankur Bhatia, Sri Manish Chheda, and Sri Saurabh Sanyal. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, let me begin by thanking ASSOCHAM for inviting Airbus and providing us the opportunity to present the industry views. It's truly an honor and a pleasure to be speaking at this august event. We live in an era of connectivity where innovation and fast-paced communication have truly shrunk the world to a global village. Every time an airline or airplane takes off or lands, our country and the world becomes more connected and more accessible. The aviation industry has been a crucial catalyst in this transformation, making it possible to travel safely over long distances. And India has been a top contributor to the global growth of the aviation sector. We are the fastest growing domestic aviation market in the world and are said to be the third largest aviation market by 2024. We have a middle class of about 350 million and the way we see is there's only 120 million are flying right now. To keep pace with the double digit growth, we actually need about 1800 airplanes to be added in the next 20 years in addition to the some 600 airplanes that are flying currently. But with such breakneck growth, the commercial sector in India is perhaps just scratching the surface of opportunity. Consider this, as of today, Indian Railways travels or makes about 8 billion trips a year. And for the aviation sector to reach 1 billion, it's going to take about 40 years. It's going to take about till 2040. So, but this forecast is in a constant policies scenario. It's very encouraging that the government is cognizant of the fact that the growth can be further accelerated and new opportunities can be unlocked by suitable policy interventions. The recent union budget addressed the aspirations of a fast modernizing India by giving the determined boost to the civil aviation sector. A sunrise sector that has the power to galvanize and create thousands of jobs in the crucial economy that's more or less required at this point. Traditionally, taxation, labor laws, import-export issues, administrative processes, availability of credit, skilled labor, infrastructure typically affect the growth of any sector. A quick analysis of these parameters provides an understanding of how suitable and timely government policy support can transform any sector, and aviation sector is obviously no exception to that. Take for example the MRO sector, and much has been talked about it already, but the growth of the nascent about $1 billion sector remains subdued due to high taxes and makes it cheaper for airlines to maintain their airplanes in countries such as Sri Lanka. Therefore, a tax adjustment could further incentivize this sector in India and turn India from an importer of MRO services to the net exporter, which is where our ambition lies. According to estimates by the MRO Association of India, the move can create about 100,000 jobs and generate revenues of about 35,000 crores in the next 5 years. For a fast-growing industry such as commercial aviation, quick maturity and self-reliance is crucial. So to this end, the budget proposal of the Union Government to make India as a hub of aviation and financing leasing will obviously help. Another era of opportunity to fire growth is rationalization of fuel prices. At present, the jet fuel accounts for anything between 25 to 35% of the airline's revenues, as we just saw from Actors Advisors, and therefore getting the ATF, aviation turbine fuel, within the GST will be a significant step towards rationalizing something like this. The trade and scale of India also provides a unique opportunity for our country to become the hub of connectivity and gateway to the world, just like Dubai is for the Middle East. We have a unique opportunity to connect countries like Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, and Maldives through a hub and spoke model and be a gateway to the world. This is where the regional connectivity scheme and Udaan scheme launched by the government plays a role. After the successful launch, driving regulation as well as economics to further mature the RCS scheme will not only drive the growth, but all will also provide us an opportunity to demonstrate leadership and drive the growth of South Asia.